This week on BSD Now, we have a very special guest joining us to tell a tale of the early days in BSD history. That, plus some new OpenSSH goodness, shell scripting utilities, and much more. Stay tuned for your place to be, SD. Now, episode 172, A Tale of BSD from Yore, recorded December 14th, 2016. Hey, I'm your host, Chris Moore.
And I'm Alan Jude.
Glad to have everybody with us this week. We got an exciting episode. We have a really good interview, which we'll be teasing you about. And we won't tell you who. We'll just surprise you. It'll happen right in the middle. Yeah. So stay tuned. You want to hear that. It's going to be fun. We have a lot of news.
Yeah, we have a couple of interesting stories to cover as well that are actually stories, not just... things we want to talk about.
That's right. So we got some stories, we got some news, but we'll go ahead and get right into them here. So first up, we have a call for testing. So of course, as you're getting ready to head into the holidays for the end of 2016, that means a lot of us are going to have some spare time on our hands, you know, maybe if you don't want to hang out with family and whatnot. So what a perfect time to get some call for testing work done. So Damian Miller has issued a public call for testing for the upcoming OpenSSH 7.4 release, which considering how much we all rely on SSH, I would expect we'll get some eager volunteers to help with testing. So you may ask, what are some of the potential breakers we should be concerned about that they want looked at? So we'll read some of these off from the notes he posted here. But he says, first of all, this release removes server support for the SSH v1 protocol. So that's gone bye-bye. Also, it looks like 3DES CBC from the client's default proposal, that's been removed. 64-bit block ciphers are not safe in 2016. He says that we don't want to wait until attacks like Suite 32 are extended to SSH. He said, as 3DES CBC was the only mandatory cipher in the SSH RFCs, this may cause some problems connecting to older devices using the default config. But it's highly unlikely that such devices already need explicit configuration for key exchange and host algorithms already anyway.
Yes.
So, or highly likely that they need that.
So for those hosts, you'll have to add a section to your SSH_config that says, hey, for that one, you know, do these things. But
I'm aware it's the old.
By default, we don't want to be proposing these older protocols because then someone could basically do a downgrade attack by making it look like the host we want to talk to is only supporting, you know, this old 3DES cipher and then being able to crack the messages going back and forth.
Yeah. That would not be good. So another thing here on the daemon side, remove support for pre-authentication compression. He said doing compression early in the protocol probably seemed reasonable in the 1990s, but today it's clearly a bad idea in terms of both cryptography, which he says there's multiple compression oracle attacks in TLS, and attack surface. Pre-authentication compression support has been disabled by default for 10 years. He said support still remains in the client, though. So that's officially been nuked. SSH agent will refuse to load PKCS modules outside of a whitelist of trusted paths by default. He says the path whitelist may be specified at runtime. SSHD, when a forced command appears in both a certificate and an authorized keys principal command equals restriction, SSHD will now refuse to accept the certificate unless they are identical. The previous documented behavior of having the certificate forced command override the other could be a bit confusing and error prone. Yeah, I can see that would be annoying. Also, SSHD removed the use login configuration directive and support for having bin login manage login session. So it looks like that's gone now as well. So those are some of the things people have concerned, you know, they have concerns about or wanted to give you a heads up on. But some of the rest of you guys are probably asking, ooh, well, 7.4, surely there's some new features. Well, we have a few of those to wake you up as well. So we have first up SSH. They've added proxy multiplexing mode to SSH, inspired by the version in PuTTY by Simon Tatum. This allows a multiplexing client to communicate with the master process using a subset of the SSH packet and channels protocol over a Unix domain socket, with the main process acting as a proxy that translates the channel IDs, etc. It says this allows multiplexing mode to run on systems that lack file descriptor passing, which are used by current multiplexing code, and potentially in conjunction with Unix domain socket forwarding with the clients and multiplexing master process on different machines. Multiplexing proxy mode may be invoked using SSH --O proxy and then the rest of your command. So that's something new to play with. They've also added a feature to SSHD config, disable forwarding option that disables X11 agent TCP tunnel and Unix domain socket forwarding, as well as anything else that they might implement in the future. He said that like the restrict authorized keys flag, this is intended to be a simple future-proof way of restricting an account. Another thing here is SSHD and SSH now support the curve 25519-SHA-256 key exchange method. So this is identical to the currently supported method named curve 25519-SHA-256@libssh.org. So they've just renamed that.
They basically dropped the @libssh.org part because it became part of the standard.
Good. Good deal. Okay. And then SSHD has improved handling of SIGHUP by checking to see if SSH is already daemonized at startup and then skipping the call to daemon if it is. This ensures that a SIGHUP restart at SSHD will retain the same process ID as the initial execution. SSHD will also now unlink the PID file prior to SIGHUP restart and recreate it after a successful restart rather than leaving a stale file in case there's a config error that stops it. That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah,
there's lots of other bug fixes. Was there any other ones you thought were important?
No, I was just trying to go through the list here of some of the other ones. They've improved key exchange fuzzer harshness, regression tests for string matching, address matching, and some string sanitization. I think these are pretty good. So definitely you should get those tests done. Be sure to send them some feedback, both positive and negative, you know, seeing as much as how every system in and every IT person relies on SSH in some way somewhere. We should probably be testing this and make sure that this is a good solid release for them. So wish them luck with this. Okay, so time to move over to our next story about printer causing excessive syscalls and UDP traffic. Okay, yes. Tell us, Alan. I read that and I was like, what?
Yes. this is a great story, but also it's also a great kind of walkthrough beginner tutorial to Dtrace as well. So I thought this one was especially good. This is from Ryan. I forget his last name now, but anyway, we'll find it at the bottom of the story here. So he's saying he was looking at his computer and seeing 3,000 syscalls a second on an idle machine. And he says, that doesn't seem right. I just booted this machine, and the only processes running were those required for the base OS, which was SmartOS, in the global zone. So normally, that's what they call the root system, whereas the containers they call zones. So there's a very minimal set of processes running, but yet there's a lot of syscalls every second. And it's like, that seems weird. So he says, well, at least I have Dtrace. I can use this one-liner to figure out what syscalls are being made across the system. So he just invokes this little one line of Dtrace, and it breaks it down and shows that the LWP sig mask, which is for setting the mask of which signals will be accepted by a process, is happening like 3,000 times a second. That seems weird.
That's odd, yeah.
He's like, wow, that's a lot of calls. Now I want to know what is being called. Now that I know what is being called, I need to find out who's doing the calling. I'll use another one-liner to show me the most common user stacks involved. So there's another Dtrace one-liner. And this one shows that most of those calls are coming from MDNSD. So he's like, okay, so this MDNSD code is causing all the trouble. So he does a third Dtrace to figure out what other syscalls MDNSD is calling. And we see that it receives message 200 times, calls the pull system call 400 times, and calls sigmask 800 times. It's like, that's a lot of signal masking and pulling. What the hell?
Sure.
So he's like, what is MDNS anyway? Is there a man page? He does some Googling and finds out that it's used to resolve host names on small networks. It's basically a zero configuration way for all the hosts to talk to each other. It uses UDP and requires zero configuration. Nothing obvious to explain why it's flipping out. I feel helpless.
Sure.
So I turn to the only thing I can trust, the code. So he looks at the code, and immediately he's like, ew.
Yeah, right? And probably wishes he hadn't looked.
Yeah, he's like, whoa, boy, this is some messy code. This would not pass the Illumo C-style checks. Turns out it's code from Darwin, the kernel of OS X.
Oh, nice. Okay.
So he's like, that explains why it looks so messy. He's like, an idea pops into my computer animal brain. I wonder if my MacBook is also experiencing abnormal syscall rates. And so he switches from his Illumos or SmartOS machine to his MacBook. And It's like, no, that can't be it. Why would both my SmartOS server and my MacBook both have the same problem? There's no good technical reason to link these two. But then again, I'm dealing with computers here, and I've seen a lot of strange things over the years. So he switches to his laptop, and because macOS 10 has dtrace, can do the same dtrace on his MacBook. He just throws sudo in front of it and does the dtrace and finds, well, this is a thing called DiscoverD that's doing the same thing on his laptop.
Interesting.
He's like, you can ignore the Google Chrome helper one there, but he's like, DiscoverD, and he looks into it, and it's, oh, that's just what OS X calls MDNSD. Mm-hmm. So it's like, okay, the same thing is going wrong on my MacBook. What the hell? So he pulls up his network monitor and finds that not only that, but it's also DiscoverD has also received 270 million packets. It's like, that seems weird. What's going on excessive there? He's like, holy shit, 237 million packets. And he looks at the SmartOS machine, and while it's only been on for a little bit, it's already got 3 million packets. So he's like, well, figure out where they're coming from. So he runs Snoop, which I think is something like a TCP dump on Illumos. And yep, there's the IP address they're all coming from, 10.0.1.8. A constant stream of MDNS packets. He's like, I know this IP is not any one of my computers. That leaves only my iPhone, my Apple TV, or my printer. Wait a minute, the printer.
That's right.
2 days earlier, I heard some beeping noises. Here's a picture of his printer. He says, I own a Canon PIXMA MG6120 printer. It has a touch interface with a small LCD on top used for various options. Since it also sits next to my desk, I sometimes lay things on top of it, like books or maybe a plate after I'm done eating. If I lay things in the wrong place, it will activate the touch interface and cause repeated pressing. Each press causes a beeping noise. If the object lays there long enough, the printer locks up and I have to reboot it. Just such an event occurred just 2 days ago. So he fires up his DLADM tool again to monitor the incoming packets in real time. Then he turns to the printer, moves all the crap off of it, which is two books and an empty plate and the title for his motorcycle that he needs to sell. He's like trying to use the touchscreen on top of the printer, but it's locked up as expected. So he cuts the power to the printer and whips his head back to his terminal. And all the packets go away. He's like, giddy, I run dtrace, and oh, the syscall count is now down to like 8. Except for dtrace doing somewhat manageable a bunch. He's like, I'm not sure whether to laugh or cry. I laugh, because lol computers. There's some dumb shit I've seen or deal with every day. Better to roll with the punches and laugh. You live longer that way.
That's true. That is true.
At least I got to flex my dtrace muscles a bit. In fact, I feel a bit like Brennan Gregg when he was debugging why OS X was dropping keystrokes. That's another story you'd have to go look up. He says, I didn't bother to root cause why my printer turned into a UDP machine gun. I don't intend to either. I have better things to do. And if rebooting solves the problem, then I'm happy. Besides, I had to get back to what I was trying to do 6 hours before I started debugging this damn thing. it's Ryan Zizeski.
There you go. Man, that's just... how many people have devices like that on their network causing problems and they don't even know it?
Yeah, it's...
that's amazing.
There you go. The Internet of Terror has already been on your land for years. Yeah, fantastic. This story is actually from 2014.
Yeah, that's crazy.
But I like the way they told the story there.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Okay. Well, next up here, we have a really fun blog post today that we need to pass along, originally authored by A. Jesse Jiru Davis, specifically the tale of one man's quest to unify the getADR info in Python with macOS and BSD. So we'll give you a small taste of this tale. Let's just pass along the introduction and give you a little flavor. He says, so tell us about the time you made DNS resolution concurrent in Python on Mac and BSD. No, you don't want to hear that story, my friends. It's nothing but old lore and ifdefs. But you made Python more scalable. The saga of Steve Jobs was sung to you by a mysterious wizard with a fanciful name. Tell us. Gather around then. I will tell you how I unearthed a lost secret, unbound Python from old shackles, and banished an ancient and horrible mutex troll. Let us look at the beginning. So, is your interest piqued? It should be. I'm not sure we could do this blog post justice by just trying to read it aloud here. It's pretty long, but we definitely recommend it if you want to see how we managed to get this bit of code working cross-platform. And it's highly entertaining as well, as the little snippet demonstrates here.
So I pulled out a couple of random quotes out of it just because they're so hilarious.
Yeah, go ahead and read them. Like, they're really good.
A long time ago in the 1980s, a coven of Berkeley sorcerers crafted an operating system. They named it after themselves, the Berkeley Software Distribution, or BSD. For generations, they nurtured it, growing it and adding features. One night, they conjured a powerful function that could resolve host names in IPv4 or IPv6. It was called getAdderInfo. The function was mighty, but in years to come, it would grow dangerous, for the sorcerers did not make getAdderInfo thread safe. As ages passed, BSD spawned many offsprings. There was FreeBSD and OpenBSD, NetBSD, and in time, macOS 10. Each made its copy of getAdderInfo thread safe at different times and in different ways. Some operating systems retained scribes who recorded these events in the annals. Some did not. So the story continues as our hero battles the mutex troll and quests for ancient knowledge. He goes on, Apple engineers are not like you and me. They are a shy and secretive folk. They publish only the code they must from Darwin. Their comings and goings are recorded in no bug tracker. Their works in no changelog. To learn their secrets, one must delve deep. And then
there's
a tiny coven of NYC BSD users who meet at a tavern called Stone Creek near my dwelling. They are aged and fierce, but I made the sign of the trident and supplicated them humbly for advice, and they were kindly to me. And then I don't think I want to spoil the ending, but just spoiler alert, so plug your ears for a second if you don't want to hear the ending. Without a word, the mercenary troll shouldered its axe and trudged off in search of another patron or other platforms. Never again would he hold hostage the worthy smith's forging Python code on BSD.
There you go.
But I highly recommend you read the whole story.
Yeah.
The story itself is great, but just because of they made it ye oldie, you know, questing story, it just becomes epic.
It reads as one of those like text-based adventures we used to do on computers in the late 80s, early 90s. It's good. It's good. Read it all. We can't do it justice on the show. So highly encourage you check it out.
Like, seriously, somebody should make a podcast of this. It's just a dramatic reading of this story.
Yes. Yes, for sure. I'd watch it. It'd be entertaining. Okay, so our last story in the top of the news here we have is using Release to create FreeBSD images for OpenStack. So tell us about what they're doing here, Alan.
So following a recent episode where we covered a walkthrough of how to modify the FreeBSD Fresh install to make it into a decent OpenStack image, and Chris and I kind of wondered aloud, well, could this just be integrated into the FreeBSD release process so that, you know, both the releases, but also the semi-weekly snapshots we have would just build this for people. So it'd be very easy to build it for, say, a slightly customized version of BSD if you're installing some patches or whatever. And, you know, being the awesome audience that you all are, one of you actually responded by doing exactly that. So the article starts, during a recent BSD Now podcast, Alan and Chris mentioned that it would be nice to have a tutorial on how to create a FreeBSD image for OpenStack using the official release tools. With that, it came to me that, number one, I do have access to an OpenStack environment, and number two, I am interested in having FreeBSD as a guest image in my environment. Looks like I'm up for the challenge. He says, previously, I had success running FreeBSD 11 release on OpenStack, but more could and should be done. For instance, as suggested by Alan, wouldn't it be nice to run the latest stable or current images? Yes, it would. Also, wouldn't it be nice if these images could be customized for specific needs? And I said yes to that as well. So after some research, I found that the current OpenStack.conf file that's already in the FreeBSD release stuff, located at user source release tools, could use some extra tweaks, and that's where he started. He created and attached a patch to the Bugzilla with the same topic, which I have a link to, but that's actually already been committed to FreeBSD's release process. So now all you have to do is fetch the FreeBSD source code and extract it into user source or somewhere. Once the code's in place, then you just use the regular build system, you know, make build world, build kernel. Then go into the release directory and do make cloudware-release with cloudware, yes, cloudware equals OpenStack, and then your VM image equals whatever, or VM image equals whatever size you want. And that's it. Mm-hmm. It will generate a qcow2 image that will be whatever size you want, although it'll be compressed down, so it'll only be about 1.4 gigs with everything in it. The entire process uses the release toolchain to generate the images and should work with any version of FreeBSD.
Nice. See, that's really cool. Mm-hmm. That's neat. Looks like it's already been committed, too. Very cool. Well, we'll look forward to having some folks. You need to try that out. If you're a OpenStack user, give it a whirl. Mm-hmm. Give some feedback. I'm sure it'd be fun to see. Okay, it's time for our first sponsor this week before we head over to our interview. So first up is going to be IX Systems, of course, the website for that, ixsystems.com/BSDnow. You want to go there and fill out the form, get in touch with their sales engineers. Let them talk to you about whatever it is you're trying to solve. What is the next solution you need to tackle? And the cool thing about the IX folks is they're going to custom design a solution that's going to fit exactly what you need, not just give you something stock off the shelf. Cool thing is they, of course, run all the latest and greatest Intel processors, and they can find you ones if you need a very specific model or particular revision of something. They're really good about that, and they love a challenge. So yes, if you want something small, FreeNAS Mini, something that can go under your desk, great. If you need to fill up a server room or, you know, just equip racks and racks and racks, they can do that. Powerhouse systems, I mean, you name it, we've probably talked about it in the show in the past. And of course, a little pro tip though, they love hearing from our listeners. They're very aware of who we are on BSD Now, and they love our community. So when you get in touch with those folks, be sure to mention you heard about it here, because they just love talking to our users. And that kind of puts you in a little bit more of an elite class of customer as well. Like, okay, these guys know what they're talking about. Let's actually talk about block sizes now and figure out, you know, how you want your storage set up, or, you know, like, we'll go into detail and whatnot. But definitely good stuff. Did you have anything you want to add, Alan?
No, I just I expect to receive an email today with the tracking number for my latest couple of servers.
Nice. Okay, we'll get in touch with them today, and of course, tell them we sent you. And if you do something unique or weird and you're allowed to talk about it, send pictures or let us know what you're doing, and we'll get some pictures, because we like showing off some of the latest crazy challenges they've been able to do. So of course, we'll look forward to hearing more of you guys' success stories in the future. Okay, well, we're joined now by Rod Grimes, BSD janitor from going way back when. So first of all, thank you so much for coming on the show today, Rod. A pleasure to have you here.
Yeah, you're welcome, Chris.
Great. Well, of course, we're going to have to ask you some of the traditional questions we ask everyone. So tell us, when did you first get introduced to Unix?
I got introduced to Unix in the early 70s at Oregon Museum of Science and Industry. They had a PDP 1145 that we used to reboot in the middle of the night to run early releases of AT&T Research Unix on.
Hmm, okay. What year did you say that was again?
Early 70s. It would have been 71, 72-ish time frame. So very early. Yeah, I was very young.
Definitely.
Got an early start.
Yeah, for sure. So what was it like back in those days working on a PDP? So that was 10 years, to give you an idea, that was 10 years before I was born, so I don't have any historical context.
Okay, PDP 11 is a sub-10 megahertz, 262 kiloword machine that can't do a whole lot. But then at that time, Unix was fairly small. Mm-hmm. Slash bin probably contained about 30 binaries or so. Okay. I don't even believe there was an S bin.
Yeah, who needed that, right?
Yeah. Who needed any other user than root at that time, too?
Uh-huh.
It was different. We used TTYs some of the machines had deck writers on them, which were 30 characters per second. So that was going really fast back then.
Oh, wow.
And then OMSI had some ties with Tektronix, so we had Tektronix 4000 series graphics terminals on them, which was really nice, because those could actually do 9600 baud and do some pretty fancy graphics for back then.
That's really cool. Well, OMSI is one thing I do know about. I used to live in that area, actually, if you didn't know, Rod. I was right across the river in Vancouver there, so not too far from you guys.
Yeah. This was when OMSI was up on the hill by the zoo, before it is now.
Okay, very
and
cool.
And so you said you rebooted the PDP 11 at night to run this, and then did you have to boot it back to what it normally ran during the day?
Yeah, they ran a RISC-C time-sharing system on it that was used for some business purposes of OMSIs, and it was used for, as a time-sharing system for some different people. And so we could only use it after like 8 or 9 o'clock at night until 6 in the morning. So
you guys were all night owls just by necessity.
Yeah. they had a PDP-8 that we used that we could use around the clock, but of course that couldn't run Unix, so it was... Mm-hmm. It ran OS 8, and you couldn't do near as much on it as you could the PDP 11.
Interesting.
Cool. So then we move forward a bit to when the FreeBSD project started. What were you actually using BSD to do around the time when you got involved with or helped found the FreeBSD project?
I was using it mainly. I had a little 286 that was for just being able to get onto the internet and was able to use some SCO Unix systems at that time that were local bulletin boards to the Portland area. And I forgot what the question was now.
What were you using BSD for when FreeBSD first started?
I was using it as when I found 386 BSD, I was using it as a slip router so that I didn't have to dial into a bulletin board system and then use a shell on it to get onto the internet type stuff. So I first started using it as a slip router locally, and then I was looking for some software tools to like SPICE and some other stuff to do electrical engineering work with is the main reason I wanted to get on the internet, and that was the early 92 time frame.
Okay, wonder if we were on the same BBS around that time frame. Was it using Orion BBS or was it something else in Portland?
Orion rings a bell. I'm having a hard time remembering the name of it. I don't even think it had a UUNet gateway to it.
Nice.
which UUCP is sure. A more correct term. We didn't even have a gateway to that. So it was, and then there was Alan Beatty was running a SCO system on a 386 that a lot of us dialed into to get shell access type stuff.
Okay. Very cool. So tell us a little bit about some of the other interesting things you've used BSD for over the years.
Disk drive data recovery. It's a very good tool for doing that. There was some DD is a wonderful thing for trying to get bad blocks off of a hard drive if you repeatedly hit on it. FreeBSD tends to not crash when you're doing that type of stuff, or other operating systems. If you wedge a ATA device or a SCSI device, you end up locked up and you can't continue to use the operating system. So it's been very useful in the data recovery arenas. A long time I've used it as a router, just in general. It's just a nice router box. You can build all sorts of neat routers with it.
Sure.
That's other interesting things I've done with FreeBSD. I did some very high volume bulk emailing that was done for it. Actually, it was an opt-in network mailing system that was used by several large enterprises.
Okay.
So what do you use FreeBSD for now?
Routers. I still use it extensively for routers. I do LAMP stuff. I have a few websites, and I run Apache and MySQL and that kind of stuff. I use it as a backroom server. For LAMP, I use it for routers and software development as a developer's platform, just to work with different software pieces and stuff. It's got a very nice feature set for that.
Sure. Well, on the flip side, then, are there some things you really just can't use FreeBSD for?
Routers. the embedded router world and stuff. Things I use a lot of DDWRT to do wireless infrastructure stuff with. And right now we don't have a FreeBSD platform that's there yet. There are some projects working in that area, and we're getting closer to it. But that's one place. There's purely on the desktop. I still use Windows pretty much as my front-end desktop, and I could probably move to X11 in a FreeBSD desktop, but mm-hmm. I often find myself grabbing for a tool and going, oh, I can get a Windows version of that.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of, I'm not there with that yet.
Yeah. I've used the FreeBSD Wi-Fi build thing to build an image of FreeBSD for like the TP-Link router that I bought, which can also do DDWRT, and that works. But because there's only 8 megabytes of storage, it's very hard to get, you know, not only FreeBSD running on it, but also say a firewall and a DHCP client and SSH. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's the same thing I've run into. Yeah. The other thing is the number of pieces of hardware that we can run on is mm-hmm. small. There's like the TP-Link router, there's a D-Link, I believe it's an 825, and there's just a small fistful of them that we support right now, where you can go look at DDWRT and it runs on hundreds of different routers, OpenWRT, any of those guys. Mm-hmm.
So thinking back again to the early 90s when FreeBSD was first getting started, what did you guys think would be BSD's biggest competitor at that time?
I had a hard time with that question, in that, were we looking at competitors? Were we trying to build a product to compete with somebody?
Or you were just using software you'd like to really, use, right?
Right. Yeah. We and it was something that it was born more out of a necessity or a desire to do that than it was we're going to build something to go compete with people or mm-hmm. Make money off of. There were some concerns about when we started the FreeBSD project, in that were we going to end up competing with 386 BSD, or were we going to end up competing with BSDI, or were we going to end up competing with NetBSD? You know, so there were some concerns about that stuff, but we weren't really out to go, you know, we got to look out for these guys because they're going to crush us. So mm-hmm. I don't think we were really worried about competitors. That's kind of how it was. We just really, there wasn't a competitor.
Right. Yeah. This is,
of course, Linux was out there, but we didn't really see that. We just saw it as another piece of open source software.
Mm-hmm.
At least from my perspective, some people are very polar on that, and that, like, you know, it's got to be BSD or we can't have any GPL or that kind of stuff. So it's part of that's perspective, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So what made you feel, however, that the benevolent dictator model was a bad idea? Was there things that you saw that made you leery of that with FreeBSD?
I'm a tyrant.
Okay.
I wouldn't have been a very good benevolent dictator, because I am a tyrant. I have strong opinions. Mm-hmm. I feel strongly about things. The other thing I think that wouldn't have fit well is, as a benevolent dictator, you kind of have to have all of the answers. And I don't believe I have all of the answers. I'm not an expert in every single piece of an operating system.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot about a lot of different operating systems. I know how most of all the subsystems work. But there's areas that there are people that know a whole lot more about than I do.
Sure.
And so from my perspective, I wouldn't have worked as a benevolent dictator. I don't think that development model is, in the long run, you're probably going to end up dividing groups mm-hmm. if you have a dictator. Whereas if it's kind of a group of people that are all working together in a cooperative environment, I think that's less likely to occur.
Sure. Yeah, I remember when I first heard about the model in FreeBSD, I kind of just assumed it came from the fact that BSD originally came out of university, and so they had this concept of having bylaws and committees and so on. But mm-hmm. then when you find the actual story, it's just, no, we were just like, I don't want to do it, so let's just get a team of people.
Right. And actually, the CSRG model, in that I hadn't been exposed a lot to how CSRG internally worked and stuff, but evidently the model we picked is actually really close to how the group at Berkeley worked, which was good. Yeah, it made a good fit.
Mm-hmm. So what do you feel are some important values that the project should cultivate in both its users and developers, and how to keep the project going?
That was a really hard question, because I had to think about that. I thought about it. I kind of got a... It's probably the idea of the review process is actually really good, and that we need to cultivate that more, and that it's the only way that you will ever get really, really good code or perfect anything is to try something, make mistakes, find those mistakes, have other people point out the mistakes you've made, and polish them off. And so that you end up with a more collaborative effort of getting there. And I think that's an important value that the project has. It's different than a lot of development models. A lot of places, you know, here's your piece of the project, you go off, you work on that, and you may be submitting it to other people for review. You may not. It may just, you know, your code, and that's how it's going to go. But I think cultivating the idea that it's fine to make mistakes, and that you'll learn from it, and that that ultimately is what will give us better code quality in the long run.
Yeah, and I think even refining that a bit more, part of the thing is that when you find a mistake in someone else's code, that when you're reviewing it or whatever, that you're making sure to state the problems with it in such a way that you kind of lead them down the right path to go forward, rather than just saying that's wrong. You say you should try doing it this way or something, if you know what that is, maybe. But and just so from both sides, from the person offering the criticism, to actually try to make it lead to getting it fixed, not just rejecting the code and being like, somebody else should try because this guy doesn't know what he's doing. But also that the person getting the reviews is taking them in such a way that they're going to keep working on it, not just give up because somebody said, I don't like the way that one bit is.
Sure. Yeah, cultivating interpersonal skills within the group is a lot of geeks don't interact real good with other people. Mm-hmm. Other people in this were, no, don't do it that way. That's just not the right way to do it. There's better ways to do that. But trying to get people to go to that better way is interpersonal skills and how you interact with them. And yeah, cultivating that is good. It's easy to close the door on somebody or just go, no, don't do that. That's the wrong way. And then walk away from it rather than trying to lead them into a better way maybe of doing things. And you might learn something in the process in doing that, and that they might have an idea that you didn't think about that they're trying to use. And so you could gain some things.
So looking back though, what would you say some of the things that you think the FreeBSD project has really done well or done right?
It's done so many things really right. The performance of the system, the networking stack, it's hard to say one thing or even a few things that it's done right. Focusing, I think, on a small architecture set, high performance, reliability, and then probably the biggest thing it did right was the ports collection idea. That just that made it a desirable environment to use, because now I didn't have to go port this piece of software that I wanted to use. Somebody else already did that work for me, and I didn't have to redo it. So the ports collection is a huge piece that it definitely did right.
I think one of the other things I really like is just observability. The way that in FreeBSD, it's very easy to tell what's happening on the system and why it's not doing the thing you want it to do, or why it's not as fast as you would hope.
Yeah, there's a lot of windows and tooling and observation stuff built in that really does work well from DTrace on down.
It's open source, so it's kind of hard to hide things.
Right, but
right?
That is true. You know, on a lot of systems, they take that attitude rather than, well, you know, we could build some tools to make it really easy to tell what's going on. Or, you know, sure, we have all these black boxes that you can open the lid and dig around inside, but we could just make the lid out of plexiglass or something so you can see in without having to risk sticking your finger in it and having it chewed off by the machine.
Or you can just leave the lid off.
Then dust gets in there.
True.
What are some of the things you think the FreeBSD project has failed to do?
You're going to make me point fingers at
people? Well, not maybe specifically, but like you're saying.
I want names.
Or specific like things. We may have. we may have stuck with the x86 architecture for too long and made that too much. In the early days, that was one of the key aspects of the project, is we were going to be really good on i386 at that time, x86 now. And that I think in the long run, one, that didn't hold in the long run, and that we did move to other architectures. And I think that's now hurting us, in that the ability to support other architectures is not as easy as it could have been if that the concept of other architectures would have been adopted earlier. I think that's hurt it, in particular MIPS and ARM, which are the two hot platforms today.
I should have jumped onto those earlier.
Or just, yeah, just the concept
that's what I'm after, is the concept of other architectures. Because if you focus on one, you start doing things in the machine independent code that isn't necessarily architecturally independent, that then makes it harder later to migrate to some of those architectures.
Right. Like, I know you were saddened by the fact that FreeBSD took so long to get onto the Raspberry Pi 3.
Mm-hmm. It got on the Raspberry Pi 3 really quick. The problem was that it was not very public that it was on the Pi 3, and that there was a snapshot made that sat in a directory that wasn't very publicized. And so other people didn't pick it up and continue to work on the bits. And it had limited support initially. I mean, it ran on the Pi 3, but the network card didn't work, and
no SMP.
The Ethernet device didn't work, and there was no graphics interface. But it did boot, and it was one of the first 64-bit operating systems to run on the Raspberry Pi 3. But yeah, it was. I think it hurt the penetration into the Raspberry Pi 3 market for FreeBSD. I think if those bits would have gotten more push initially and would have been more visible up front, we could have taken a stronger hold in the ARCH 64 embedded world.
I think that's definitely one of the things that the project has not done as well as it could, is just publicizing its work and talking about itself and the things it can do. You know, there's a lot of people that would really, who really like to use FreeBSD if they only knew that it was an option or that it did actually solve the problem that they were having.
Yeah. Well, this is kind of related then, since you saw the beginning of the project and, of course, where it's come to today. Are there other areas you'd like to see FreeBSD grow into, aside from just maybe the embedded space?
The embedded space is a strong one. I think it needs to move into that space. I mean, there's only so many desktops, and that's two orders of magnitude less than the number of embedded machines we have out there. So I think that it would be good to get into the embedded one. Other areas that I'd like to see it move into, the virtualization world. We've done really, really good in the server arena for a long time. We've done okay on the desktop. We've done pretty good on the developer's desktop, people doing software development like FreeBSD for doing development on as a platform. We've done well in that world. The current generation of the server world gets us into this hypervisor arena, and I think that's something that FreeBSD is coming up on. I think it's something that it needs to do well. To continue to be a stronghold in the server market, it would doing hypervisor, Beehive in particular, is something I really want to see it shine at.
Sure. So you think something more along the lines of something like SmartOS, where you can just set up one FreeBSD machine and then a rack of other FreeBSD machines will boot up off that image and then run virtual machines, kind of thing?
I'm not familiar with SmartOS. The environment you're discussing sounds kind of where I'm going. I'm looking at this as a virtualization platform for doing FreeBSD as a services or delivery of any operating system running on top of a virtualized bare metal machine. I won't name competitor products, but we all know that there are several main backroom hypervisors that are available out there, and I think FreeBSD needs to try and move closer to what those platforms are delivering. And it's got a long ways to go. It's not an easy thing to do. Some of the tools that come with that are, you know, live migration and suspend and restores and those type of things. And those are tough problems to solve.
So, yes, that kind of segues into what three things would you like to see most from FreeBSD in 2017?
I have to cheat too much. You're getting me on the spot with these. three things I'd like to see next year. Removal of the GPL code. It's actually a project goal that came up in 2016 at BSDCAN. I'd like to see that. That's kind of been in the back of everybody's mind since the very beginning. The idea of a GPL clean release is I don't know if we can do it in 2017.
Right. Well, it's still a good goal to have.
The goal is in time for 12.0, which will be...
Yeah, that's officially the project goal, but maybe I want to see it sooner than that. the other one that I already mentioned a little bit of it is, and that would be to move ARM and or MIPS to a tier one type platform support situation so that we're a little more forefront and have more availability as far as the development environment. A lot of the tools to work in that environment are still outside of the base system, outside of what we're making available. And I'd like to see some movement in that. And then, of course, I'd like to see a whole lot of hypervisor stuff happen in 2017.
And that kind of segues into the next question.
That does. So tell us a little bit about the work that we hear you've been doing with GPU pass-through for Beehive.
I've run a typical geek desktop of 2 to 4 monitors and have for a long time wanted to be able to reduce that from a couple of boxes with GPUs in them to literally one box with running a hypervisor supporting any operating system I want on any of the 4 monitors. Type scenario. So I've tried to do that on a couple of different platforms. You know, Zen can do it and ESXi can do it. And they tend to be very, you've got to be really careful in all the hardware bits that you pick to try and put together to support that environment. I would like to see Beehive do that and have become involved through Michael Dexter to start working on seeing what we can do to make Beehive actually run with the GPU. We actually had some kind of success the other night in that we can actually see the GPU in the probe messages inside of Beehive. You can't run anything on it, but you can actually see, yes, there you have a PCI device there, and it's getting some mapped IO space. The memory block is missing right now is one of the problems. But hopefully in 2017, early 2017, we'll actually have working GPU pass through in a Beehive environment.
Oh, boy, that sounds fantastic. Yes. I've been wanting that for a while.
Yeah, I think there was a survey done about what people want to see in Beehive, and that was one of the top three items was to see GPU. Because it's got a lot of interesting applications. Virtualized desktops are very powerful. Of course, the second generation of virtualized GPU is where you actually have the GPU hardware that can support virtualization so that now instead of just passing through the GPU to one virtual machine, you're passing it through so much of it to so many different virtual machines. Yeah. And that will probably may never happen. It may happen at some point in the future. That's a pretty tough.
I think I saw the news announcement was this week. AMD released a new set of cards that have SRIOV so that the video card exposes multiple virtual devices that you can pass one into each different virtual machine, kind of like you do with the higher-end network cards can do now. A GPU that has that. So it sounds like that is coming. And so it'd be...
But the hardware is coming, but doing the virtualization support to use SRIOV from a graphics standpoint is, you know...
there's some tough things that have to be solved there.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. The next one here.
So then we get to the easy questions.
Yep.
So
are there any?
Yeah. And how do you keep yourself motivated to work on open source stuff?
for a long time, it was revenue source. I had side businesses and stuff that, in one way or another, were creating income from working with open source. I've done consulting over the years and stuff, and that, of course, it makes you kind of motivated when it's your income that's depending upon it. There's also been, you know, I like to tinker with things. So there's always the side little things and that I want to be able to do this and that isn't available yet. So I'll work on trying to make that available. Like I really want this. I want to be able to get rid of these hardware boxes and get it down to one boxes for the virtualized desktop environment. So there's a personal motivation that I would like this because it would make things simpler for me.
Right. Scratching your own itch.
And those help keep you
scratching your own itch.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that helps a lot to keep motivated with open source. The long run success in it is simply seeing the fact of how successful it can be. I mean, I don't know how many copies of FreeBSD are installed, but that's always a big motivator going, you know, look at what this thing has done. Mm-hmm. There's been a lot of companies' whole back room runs on FreeBSD in one way or another. And that just, I couldn't have looked forward at 92 and gone, wow, it's going to do all of these neat things. But looking back at words, it's really motivating to see what it has done.
Sure. And what it still could do, like the potential there for even more.
Yes.
Yeah. Cool. So what are some of your hobbies outside of open source?
Some people know from history and stuff. I'm an avid skydiver, former skydiver. I actually stopped skydiving in 2001. But that's was a long time hobby. I like to fix stuff. I tinker. I find old broken stuff. It may not necessarily be old. It's just broken stuff. Discarded people sure. stuff. People don't want anymore. And I see if I can fix it. So I like to tinker. That's not restricted to electronic stuff. I fix mechanical things, washers, dryers, TV sets, just about anything that's broken, I'll try and fix.
Right.
It has a very low cost threshold because it's usually something somebody's discarding. And frequently I try and fix it for as little as I possibly can. It's just, it's kind of a,
it's the hacker mindset.
It makes you feel Yeah, it you're, makes you feel good about going, look at what I fixed.
You're an entropy warrior. You're basically fighting the entropy all the time and fixing things.
Yes, there's a guy that has a TV shop down in Grants Pass that his motto, another one saved from the dump. And that he does some very good videos on repairing older TV sets that were basically probably going to be discarded.
Okay, very cool.
Have a lot of hobbies. There was, I don't know if you, I flew model aircrafts at one time. I was into that. I kind of took a hobby up recently of learning new different types of things. I actually watched a whole bunch of YouTube on particle physics. I'm not going to be a particle physicist, but let's go learn about particle physics. And it was just some interesting things. I think some of that was, you know, these guys are using some really big compute power and some really big storage stuff to do that. It'd be kind of interesting to learn about what it is they're trying to do.
Yeah, what are they accomplishing on that?
And, you know, how could they do it better with FreeBSD?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah.
So, was there any other topics you wanted to cover?
Not specifically.
Okay. Well, no, this has been fantastic, though. I think that was good.
Thank you very much, Tom.
Well, we thank you so much for coming on the show and taking the time with us today, Rod. It's been a pleasure. Okay, time for our next sponsor before we go to the news roundup. So next up we have is DigitalOcean. Website for that, of course, digitalocean.com. Yeah, we've been talking about these guys for a long time, but they do some really cool stuff. If you've not checked them out before, maybe find a little time today to steer your web browser over to that website, take a look. And while you're there, create an account. It's a free to create an account. Don't worry about that. You can do it. And then you put a little money in, but here's a tip. On the coupon code section, if you put the code FreeBSDNOW, that'll give you a $10 credit. Mm-hmm. So basically, you can run their lowest NVM for 2 months for free, try it out, and of course, that's still on an SSD, and you can run FreeBSD on it, you know, which is really, really cool. But if you wanted to run it by the hour, you can do that as well. Yes. You could stretch that $10 out for quite a while.
So the per hour thing worked out great for me. As I mentioned a bit last week, we actually split up 36 copies of their less than 12 cents an hour instance, which gives you 8 gigs of RAM four cores, 80 gigs of SSD, and 5 terabytes of internet transfer. And we had a large video event, and we needed a bunch more servers. And, you know, buying 36 more servers would have been a bit of a strain on our budget. But
especially if you didn't know if you're going to need them after that event, right?
Specifically when we knew we'd only need them for the one weekend. Whereas we spun them up by just hourly at DigitalOcean, and it you know, ended up not costing very much at all. It's a great way to be able to just, especially if, you know, the other one is if you're just messing with things. The best part about DigitalOcean is it's actually always billing you hourly. So you don't have to decide when you start if you want it hourly or monthly or whatever. You can just spin up the $5 one, try some stuff, then decide, okay, that didn't work. Yeah. I don't want it, throw it away. Or you say, oh, I want to keep that. You can actually say, okay, size that up and actually make it into one of the slightly more expensive ones that gives me more RAM. So it allows you to start with the smallest one and grow when you need to, but you can also shrink back as long as you don't grow the disk.
Sure. And you can do things like, you know, since you're spinning it up on the fly there, you can do that programmatically as well. So say you have some sort of need where you need to spin it up and do a particular thing and then shut down, right? Then you're only being billed for the hours you use, which is pretty cool. Yeah. They provide a full set of APIs that let you do that as well. Like, you don't have to manually do any of this. But definitely cool.
I wouldn't want to make someone sit there and manually create 36 machines. Although, if you want to create a bunch of identical ones, they actually have a nice thing in it. Even... unlike some other places, when you ask it to create 6 or whatever, it will actually figure out your numbering scheme and do it properly. Whereas, you know, the other one, we created a machine called, you know, something.scaleengine.net, and we click make a second one, it's like something.scaleengine.net 1. It's like, you just added a number to the end of the host name, making it invalid. That's not right.
No, thank you. Anyway, yeah, if you get in touch with the folks over at DigitalOcean and you happen to talk to somebody from there, tell them you heard about it here on BSD Now. I know we would appreciate that. Okay, so the news roundup. So first up, have you ever had to configure the FreeBSD auto mounting daemon or AMD? Well, today we have a blog post that walks... No, this is AMD. Oh, okay. This is the AutoFS stuff. But today we have a little blog post that's going to walk us through some of the configuration knobs that you have at your disposal to do that, which is pretty cool. So first up, the writer Tom shows us his etc/fs tab file and various UFS partitions he has set up with the no auto flag, so they're not mounted at system boot. That's important because if you have them mounted all the time, it doesn't make any sense to use AMD. But from there, then he sets up an AMD.conf file, which is pretty basic. It just has options enabled to restart mounts and unmount them on exit, so get rid of them when they're not needed. So where users are going to want to pay attention the most, though, is in the crafting of the AMD.map file, which he has a picture of. He shows what his looks like here. Within this file, you have all the various command foo, which performs mounts and unmounts of the targeted disks or file systems on demand. So when you go to that directory, it automatically gets mounted, and when it's not needed anymore, it can go away. So, of course, pay special attention to that file. It does look a little bit busy. A lot of special characters in there. All those matter, so a stray or missing semicolon could be a source of some sadness. So definitely keep an eye on what you're doing there. But lastly, just a few knobs in rc.conf will enable the various services, and then a reboot should confirm the functionality. If it all comes up and you go to that directory and it just mounts and works, then hey, you're in business. Yeah. And you have now configured it. AutoFS is something a little different, but maybe we'll get an article about that someday down the road.
But yeah, this is interesting. Just, you know, in his particular case, he's got 2 external SATA disks and an external USB 3 disk, and you know, it's better for everybody, you know, your power bell and the disk, if when you're not using it, it can spin down. So by unmounting it, it makes sure that nothing's going to poke it every so often and keep it spun up. And it can help the drive stay cooler and use less power. And it's quite a useful little tidbit.
Definitely good stuff. So if you have some sort of need for that, definitely take a look at it. I've never really had to use AMD myself. I've been okay with just using the NFS auto mounting stuff in /net, but this definitely looks interesting.
Yeah, like most of the places I've heard about this type of thing is like large universities where, you know, there's a lot of machines and you have all these NFS mounts and you don't want to keep them open, all of them open all the time. You just open them as you need them.
Sure. So definitely take a look if that's something you find yourself needing. Okay, so what's the next story we have here, Alan? Something about Libre SSL?
Yeah, so this is from a Libre SSL themed hackathon that they had in, I think it was Toulouse. So this is a report from Ingo Swarzy, and he says, back in the spring of 2 years ago, Christoph's Drunzen created Pod2MDoc, a conversion utility that converts the Perl documentation library stuff into Mandoc so that you can have man pages. And he says, less than a month later, the open or the Libre SSL project began. During the summer hackathon of that same year, back at G2K14, Anthony Bentley started using this Pod2MDoc to convert some of the Libre SSL manuals into man pages. But back then, doing so was still a pain because Pod2MDoc still had bugs and missing functionality. And, you know, Anthony was forced to basically translate the synopsis sections by hand and fix up all the function and cross-references in the body and a bunch of that type of thing. He speedily finished all of this for libSSL, and so in the autumn of the same year, he mustered up the courage and committed that. But nearing the end of the following winter, Ingo improved the Pod2MDoc tool to actually become convenient in practice, so increasing the usability of it and so on, and started working on libcrypto, converting about 50 out of the 190 manuals for that. And it says, then Max Fillinger has helped a bit and converted a handful of pages, but he feared, you know, it tired too much checking and committed his work, and he quickly gave up on the task. After that, almost nothing happened for about a full year. But he says, now, with this hackathon, he was finally fed up with the mess in the situation and decided to put an end to it. So he went there and finished the conversion of the remaining 130 manual pages for libcrypto, such that now you can view all the documentation, and he shows off some of the fancy features in MDoc. In particular, if you do man minus LK and then FA equals big num, this will find any function that takes big num as an argument, and then you can use the built-in searching support they built with less to search for, say, you know, ECDSA sign, and then find all the particular things you're looking for. And the trip report goes more into detail about a bunch of it, and even actually has a timeline, starting with the prehistory of the conversion of Libre SSL, because some of this stuff happened before Libre SSL existed. And then it goes through, you know, antiquity, as about 60 or 83 of the pages were converted in 2014, and then the Middle Ages in 2015, as more and more stuff got converted, and then into the modern era where the rest of the pages got converted.
Okay, that's pretty cool. Well, excellent. Okay, so next up, I've pretty much, if you've been watching for a long time, you know I've made no secret of my love for shell scripting. I mean, that's just always been my bread and butter. Well, today we have a new or somewhat new tool to us, a tool to bring your way. So have you ever needed to deal with large lists of data, perhaps as the result of a long, specially crafted pipe that gives you a whole bunch of fields and whatnot? And what if you need to select a specific value from, say, that range of data and then continue on processing? Well, enter the SMenu utility, which can make your scripting life just a little bit easier. So I'll just read from their description. So SMenu is a selection filter, just like sed is an editing filter. This is a simple tool that reads words from the standard input and presents them in a cool interactive window after the current line on the terminal, and writes the selected word, if any, on the standard output. So he says, after unsuccessfully searching for the net I wanted, he said, I decided to try and write my own. He said, I've tried hard to make its usage as simple as possible. It should work even when using an old VT100 terminal and is UTF-8 aware. So what this means is, in your interactive scripts, you can make it much easier to present the user with a cursor-driven menu to select from a range of possible choices, maybe as the result of a long pipe of grabbing things and grepping things and whatnot, without needing to craft a bunch of dialogue flags and throw it in a dialogue, which I've had to do that in Shell before, and that's not pleasant. So this looks a heck of a lot nicer. So definitely take a look. If you're another shell scripter fan like me, you'll be able to find some creative uses for your shell scripts in the future. But I'm looking forward to incorporating this in any of our future tools as well.
Yeah, this kind of reminds me of Pipecut. Although Pipecut is for helping you build that pipeline all the way to the end, this allows you to actually just copy and easily copy and paste the chunk you want out of the output when you're actually done. So they even complement each other. So I think this is really cool.
They complement each other well. And, you know, you can still use things like dialogue. But in this case, it's like I don't have to – before it was like you had to take all the arguments or all the things and then craft this funky-looking long dialogue argument list. And then, you know, the formatting was tricky to get right. But this is kind of like I can just dump a range of values and say, okay, now select one with your cursor, hit enter, and the script goes on, right? So yeah. Definitely
cool. And then we have this other problem that dialogue is GPL.
Oh, yes, yes, that is true. And that is true.
That means it's going to have to go away. And then that means
we don't have a BSD licensed dialogue. I didn't think about that.
So we need a new installer again.
Oh, no. I didn't think about that. Yeah, that's true. I guess there goes the installer.
Wow. I think I have a couple
of ideas. What do you do? Write it in C and do S curses?
I've played a little bit with that. And, you know, it's. That seems like that would be a lot of work.
Sure.
And then I'm like, well, maybe if I could just make a couple of dialogues to get the information I need to write a PC sysinstall text-based config.
And then just let ours do it.
Yeah. So just a small graphical interface to let you choose the options and then fire it off to, you know, a backend that automates the rest of it.
Okay. Well, let me know if you need to talk about that at some point down the road. Okay, well, tell us about our next story here, Alan. We have something about Ubuntu isn't free software.
Yes, so this has been an ongoing battle that Ubuntu is having here. In particular, they've come up with some guidelines or standards or something about what can be called Ubuntu. And that's pretty normal for any trademark type thing like that. But in this particular case, it's a blog post where Canonical is taking a stance against unofficial Ubuntu images on various cloud providers. So in particular, when the cloud provider makes a couple of changes to, say, integrate the Ubuntu into their environment, you know, like adding the stuff so that when it boots up, it pulls in the startup scripts and the packages and so on so that you get a working Ubuntu on your various cloud providers. And Canonical basically wants to charge a fee to the cloud providers for providing Ubuntu.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. And so Matthew Garrett's point here is that it's not free software in that case. So the text in question here is goes like this: any redistribution of modified versions of Ubuntu must be approved, certified, or provided by Canonical if you're going to associate it with the trademarks. Otherwise, you must remove and replace the trademarks and will need to recompile the source code to create your own binaries. This does not affect your rights under any open source licenses applicable to any of the components of Ubuntu. If you need us to approve, certify, or provide modified versions for distribution for you, you will require a license agreement with Canonical for which you will be required to pay. For further information, please contact us. So, yeah.
So you can't just... Wow, that sucks.
And so basically, I understand they don't really want you to use the word Ubuntu, but then at the same time, it's like, well, if the users would like Ubuntu on the cloud, how can we, you know, give them
something? So would that affect like a DigitalOcean? Like you can't say we offer Ubuntu?
Yeah, well, unless you pay Canonical for it. I think maybe you can do it if you don't modify it at all. It's a little unclear. But there's a link to the actual blog post from Mark Shuttleworth if you want to see
that. Yeah, that gets really hairy, though, because what is modification, right? Because I know like DigitalOcean has to have some script set up on the FreeBSD instance, for example. Because
they don't use DHCP. They use the Avahai MDNS auto zero configuration system to actually assign the IP addresses. Mm-hmm. So
is that a modification or not? Like,
if you're not allowed to use the Ubuntu trademark, how does it work to the fact that they put the word Ubuntu in every one of their package version numbers?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like, you have to compile everything yourself? And do they provide the tools to do that? You know, on FreeBSD, it's very easy. Make release. But I don't know how what that process even looks like on Ubuntu. So anyway, Matthew Garrett's post says here, Mark Shuttleworth just blogged about their stance against unofficial Ubuntu images. The assertion is that certain cloud hosters are providing unofficial modified Ubuntu images and that these images are meaningfully different from upstream Ubuntu in terms of their functionality and security. Users are attempting to make use of these images and are finding they don't work properly and are assuming that Ubuntu is a shoddy product. This is an entirely legitimate concern, and if Canonical were acting to reduce user confusion, then they should be commended for that. the appropriate means to handle this type of issue is trademark law. If someone claims that something is Ubuntu when it isn't, that's probably an infringement of the trademark, and it's entirely reasonable for trademark owners to take action to protect the value associated with their trademark. But Canonical's IP policy goes much further than that. It can be interpreted as meaning, with a little caveat we'll get back to, that you can't distribute work based on Ubuntu without paying Canonical for the privilege, even if you call it something other than Ubuntu. And it says that, and by interpreted as meaning, I mean that's what it says, and Canonical refuses to say otherwise. If you ask a copyright holder if you can give a copy of their work to someone else, assuming it doesn't infringe on their trademark, they say no or insist you need an additional contract, then it's not free software. If they insist that you recompile source code before you give copies to someone else, it's not free software. Asking that you remove trademarks that would otherwise infringe trademark law is fine, but if you can't use their trademark in non-infringing ways, that's still not free software. He says, Canonical's IP policy continues to impose restrictions on all of these things, therefore Ubuntu is not free software.
Wow. Oh, that sounds like an interesting issue that's going to have to be untangled over the upcoming years, I'm sure. But okay. Well, thanks, Alan, for giving us an update on that.
From a BSD side, I'm happy to see Linux is having these kind of fights, and maybe more and more cloud providers will offer
free BSD. You can't say that.
Well, maybe this will get more cloud providers to offer FreeBSD, knowing that they won't have this problem with that.
That is true. That is true. FreeBSD won't come around and bite you that way if... Yeah, I don't think anyone's going to complain about what cloud providers are doing. But anywho. Okay, well, good stuff. Well, thanks, Alan, for giving us that story. Okay, folks, we still got Beastie Bits to get to and feedback and questions. But really quick before we do that, our last sponsor this week, which, of course, is Tarsnap. Website for that, tarsnap.com/BSDnow. You want to go there and get your account created. But while you're there, you can grab a client, which they have clients for just about everything under the sun, even a Windows client if you want it, but just about every Unix, Linux, etc. And the cool thing is about doing Tarsnap backups is if you don't trust the client, for example, you're paranoid, which based on like a compiler story we talked about last week, I'm feeling a little paranoid myself still. So you can compile things yourself and still not trust it because the compilers may be infected as well. But anyway, aside from that, Tarsnap, the cool thing is they give you the source code. You can audit it. You can look at it. You can see that it does what it's supposed to be doing and making sure that you're not trusting some random binary from somewhere on the internet, which is really cool. How many backup solutions promise that? And what's really cool is they make some really good claims and they back it up with bounties. So, you know, Colin's been running these things for a while now. If you can find a bug or a serious bug, like they actually pay you, which I don't know if anyone's been able to take him up on that in quite a while. It's pretty darn solid. But take a look at Tarsnap today. The cool thing is it lets you do fully encrypted backups the right way, which means everything's encrypted locally on your disk and your system before it gets sent out over the wire. And also the key only lives on your side as well. So you don't have to worry about anybody on the remote end being able to snoop and look at your data and figure out what it is.
Tell what files you have that are the same with files other people have. And
Correct. Which I'm sure makes some of the cloud people cranky because they can't dedupe stuff. Yeah. But yeah, too bad. That's just the price you pay if you want privacy. Yeah. So, anyway.
There's no way around it if you want to design it to be secure.
That's right. So that's a good thing in this case.
Tarsnap has four guiding principles, right? Security, flexibility, efficiency, and utility.
Right? That's right. And I think it solves all those pretty handily.
He says,
Backups
should be provided as a utility with linear pricing, forcing people to figure out ahead of time how much data they want to back up so that they can sign up for the right plan is dumb.
Sure.
And having some customers subsidize other customers is inherently unfair.
Mm-hmm. Well, definitely check it out. Tarsnap makes it super cheap. I think I put my first $20 in a year and a half, 2 years ago, and it's still like over $15 or something left.
I did mine for New Year's 2015. So almost up to 2 years now, and I've not made a dent in my $20 yet.
That's right. So you guys should put that to work for you. The cool thing is if you already know how to use the tar command, you're 90% of the way there. It's a very similar tar-like syntax. Set it up, automate it in your cron job, and you are good to go. Backup's done every night securely and only backing up the bits that change. So that's what helps keep that cost down. But definitely check it out today. If you talk to anyone there, tell them you heard about it here on BSD Now. Okay, so Beastie Bits time. So first up, OpenSense has a new release they've dropped. It looks like 16.7.10 has landed. They said they're addressing some regressions caught by the users. They've updated their ports to include the latest versions of NTP Squid and Strong Swan. And then they have some full patch notes here. But don't see anything here. Just a lot of small bugs and new ports, it looks like. But I guess they said they're working on a development version for the upcoming 17.1 beta, which they said they will be publishing right after the Wi-Fi config and last known trouble with PHP 7.0 and the GUIs gets fixed. So hopefully a big new release here soon. That'll be fun for 2017. Yep. Okay, so next up we have some donor news to give you. So the OpenBSD Foundation welcomes its first Iridium donor, Smartzian, which donated, I think, was it $280,000?
Yeah, $280,000 Canadian. So Smartzian is a cell phone company in China, and they have these big launch events where they charge tickets to get into the event. And there's like over 10,000 developers and tech enthusiasts have attended these events. And each year they choose a project to donate the proceeds to. And this year they chose OpenBSD.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. Well, I'm sure they appreciated that, and we thank them as well. And speaking of that, so now on the FreeBSD side, we have Jan Combe over from WhatsApp has donated another $500,000 to FreeBSD this year. So they've announced it as their new Uranium donor, which that's a big deal. That's big money. But, of course, we appreciate that. And we were talking about it right before we started recording the segment, too. But the total number of donors is important, too. So while these big donations are awesome and the foundations appreciate them, keep doing the smaller donations and don't forget to do yours for the end of the year, because that total donor number really counts as well for tax purposes and whatnot.
In particular, for the FreeBSD Foundation to keep its charity status, the IRS does it's called like the public good test or something like that.
Yeah.
Public interest test. And there has to be enough interest from regular people, not otherwise it's just an industry consortium of the big donors.
Yeah, you could have three large companies donate $1 million a year and then get tax write-offs, and that wouldn't be cool.
But they have a great quote here from Jan Combe saying, well, WhatsApp today is used by over 1 billion people. It's FreeBSD that provides the reliability and performance and helps our engineers keep WhatsApp service running efficiently and trouble-free.
Very cool.
So the FreeBSD project is still well short of its goal to raise $1.25 million for this year. Still need another about $360,000. But even without that, it'd be very nice to see that number of donors get much higher. So, you know, even if you donate only $5 or $10, just doing that to get more names on the list will make a big difference for the project.
Okay. Very cool. Well, let's see. So our last Beastie Bits here, we have the Soviet Russia BSD Makes You. So tell me what this is about. Demos, I guess, was a derivative of BSD they had developed in the Soviet Union. Yeah. Do you know any more about this, Alan?
Yeah, so it was called Demos. It stood for... this is going to be fun.
How do you say... I can't
Dialog Vaya, Edinaya, Mobilanaya, Operastashnaya, Sistema. Or Interactive Unified Portable Operating System. It was a Unix-like operating system developed in the Soviet Union, derived from BSD. It was created in 1982 at the Institute of Atomic Energy in Moscow. And was a clone of, originally derived from MNOS, which was their clone of Unix version 6. Demos versions 1.x were gradually merged from 1986 until 1990, leaving the joint OS Demos version 2 with support for different Cyrillic character sets and so on. Originally, it was developed for the SM4, which was a PDB-11 clone, and the SM1600, and then it went on to run on clones of the VAX and then on Motorola 6820-based microcomputers.
I guess they stopped at 91 when they switched to something called RELCOM. And that was the new project. Oh, interesting. Okay. Well, thank you, Alan. And I guess it's time to jump over to feedback and questions. Yep. So first up, we have Jason. So pay attention to this, folks. But we have a hello, Chris, Alan, and Chris. Okay. He says, I'm a senior architect manager at a Fortune 100 company that you've definitely heard of, which I can't name. And earlier this year, I was looking to add a couple seasoned sysadmins to my team. One of my favorite interview questions is, how do you stay current on industry news, patches, security products, etc.? Because I found that's always the best indicators of technical passion which almost always maps directly to creativity and success here. Usually I hear Slashdot or Rs, which are decent answers, but not standouts. So he says, I was floored when one guy said, a couple podcasts like TechSnap, BSD Down, the Linux Action Show from Juniper. He said, I actually cut him off there to save him the trouble going into detail. And instead, we spent the next 15 minutes talking about our favorite episodes and the nearly unlimited tips we picked up from you guys over the years. He was easily one of the most qualified applicants I've seen in years. And yes, we made him a very solid offer. Unfortunately, right after, his wife got a can't refuse job overseas and had to decline the position to move. He said, I don't have a question, but I wanted to let you know that your audience, let you and your audience know the value of your shows from an unusual angle. Oh, I think that is really cool. I wonder if other people have success stories like that.
Yes.
Maybe we have like a BSD Now to certification or something that we can issue, like long time listener award or whatever. Yes. And you can put it on your resume. There you go. Yes. That's really good.
Yes. That definitely makes us feel good. And, mm-hmm. you know, I hope it helps more people.
Good. Okay, so next up we have a hello BSD Now team. This is a follow-up to an email I sent last year asking about your preferred shell. Well, it's a year later, and I've spent many days with shell scripting. I've even used it at work to clean up a lot of loose ends and document on my blog. With it, I hope to encourage others not to fear the shell and use it to enhance their workflows. He says, you're doing all a great job bringing new people to BSD and hope you had a great time at Meet BSD 2016. That was from Hamza. So, well, we appreciate the follow-up, and that's really cool. I like highlighting this kind of stuff. It's like he got inspired. We asked a question about shell, and a year later, he's a shell scripting guru now, using it for everything.
Link for his blog appears to have gone missing. We'll have to fix that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we'll have to fix that up. But yeah, that is really cool. Well, we thank you, Hamza, and we wish you all the luck with your future shell scripting endeavors. And don't be shy. Come out to one of these conferences if you get a chance. Okay. And then the next one here,
Dave,
is short.
I'll read it. Yep, Dave asks about migrating to FreeBSD. He says, hello. My day job is moving to FreeBSD, and we wrote a thing about it. We're the little domain registrar that could.
He has a link. It's actually a pretty full blog post. I toyed with putting it in the show as well, but I wanted to make sure we just didn't ignore it or whatever, because it's actually a really good write-up on their transition moving from Debian over to FreeBSD for their provider here.
Huh. Now, I thought that was pretty cool. There was one a couple of years ago. I can't remember where, but there was a SSL certificate authority that found that running Red Hat under Beehive on FreeBSD was faster than running Red Hat on the hardware or something.
Oh, interesting.
I forget what it was.
This is very interesting. But anyway. Okay. Well, anyway, take a look at that if you get a chance and you want to read about their journey on migrating. If that's something your business is interested in, you might get some good tips out of that.
Yeah. There's also from a couple of years ago, I think 2014, maybe even 2013, there's a BSDCAN talk about switching from Linux to BSD. And it's... mostly targeted at switching a company from Linux to BSD, and it actually covers the whole process from like getting people interested in it, explaining to the boss why it'll actually be useful, actually following through from it, solving problems, and making sure that, you know, people aren't just like, ah, stupid thing, let's switch back to Linux kind of thing. It even covers how to keep them switched, because you know, getting places switched is usually just a matter of having the clout and the ability to push for it and actually make it happen, but keeping them from going back later is a whole different thing.
That's true. That is true. You want to read the next one from Dan here?
Yes. So Dan writes in asking about which BSD. So he says, first of all, thanks for the awesome show. A bit of background. He's a web developer, and he prefers a clean, consistent system over anything else. So migrated completely to Linux when Windows 8 came out. Then I got started with BSD through Ghost BSD some years ago. And also found out about BSD Now when I had just aired one of the very first episodes. Since then, I've been watching the live stream for quite a while, enjoying tutorials, and sometimes even joining in on the IRC. Nowadays, I'm listening to the recordings on my phone while traveling. I know a lot of people do that. This is about 2 years ago. I finally built my own NAS powered by the Sharky free NAS, of course, and serving to my Android tablets through the Plex Media Jail. I've also set up a GitLab jail and... you know, when that wasn't in the ports tree and there were no plugins. And luckily, someone has since made a nice setup script for that. Anyway, in the meantime, I've spun up some DigitalOcean droplets running FreeBSD for different things, to store slides for talks and stuff like that, and demos, and a bunch of other different things. I'm usually on Linux, like Gentoo or Arch, so sometimes I'm a bit confused with a few of the different differences, like the command switches aren't quite the same. But he says, FreeBSD has always been a great experience. I've tried OpenBSD, which was fun until I accidentally DD'd the wrong target once. Dev SDA is not the USB drive, as it turns out.
Right.
Anyway, long story short, now that I have more experience and my company is giving new laptops to the employees, I wanted to put FreeBSD on mine. The question is now which distro to choose. Currently, there's three that he's kind of picking from. Not including the basic FreeBSD, because that'd be too easy, apparently. So he's got PackBSD, which used to be called ArchBSD. So that's only partly FreeBSD, so I wouldn't pick that. And then Gentoo FreeBSD is basically the same thing.
The big difference is there, too, they use the Pac-Man Package Manager. It's not even PKG. Yeah. So if you're not down with that, that may not be your best choice. But if you like Pac-Man, there you go.
And the Gentoo one, that sounds really hard. Yeah, I didn't even know that was a thing. Yeah. And then you have TrueOS or PCBSD, and he says, which I know from you guys and Chris's brother Ken, of course, which is basically FreeBSD with all the package stuff and the usual ports tree, but pre-installed with the GUI and some extra options and so on. Yes, I would agree that that's probably the easiest way to get started. He says, tending towards TrueOS because it looks like the project is doing very well, and he's occasionally runs LumenaDE on Linux for guests on his machine, and he says he's familiar with it. I could contribute to the project and maybe make Lumina's panel compatible with other Windows managers like i3, which is what he mainly uses. Plus, he says, I know the pleasure of building Qt and upgrading it from Gentoo. My requirements include encrypted partitions either way, since I'll have company data on the machine. Plus, I need to write some ports myself because of the software we're using. So, yeah, I definitely think of those options, TrueOS is your best bet. When he said different distros of FreeBSD, I was thinking maybe he was talking about like GhostBSD or something and vanilla and then TrueOS. But I'd say TrueOS is definitely the easiest way to get started.
I think we will hit all those checkboxes you have of things you want to do. So encrypted partition, you can do full disk still if you want with the Grub bootloader right now. If you want, we offer home directory encryption using Jelly or PEFS. So Jelly would be an external home directory, like on a USB stick. PEFS would live on top of ZFS, so you could do that as well. So you got some different options to play with. And, of course, everything's Qt-based that we do, so you should have no problem getting around there. But I guess he had a question about any further recommendations I should keep in mind. He said the hardware should be fine. He's on a Tuxedo Book, which is the same device as the System76 Lemur, which was designed for Linux. So, yeah, I'd say give TrueOS a shot with it. So we are also switching not really the init system, but the RC system here to OpenRC. So that'll be a little different. If you've come from a Linux background, people might know about that or it would look familiar anyway. But we've seen some huge speed up gains in boot time and shutdown. And just it is really nice to have the RC status command, which shows you in a nice formatted way all the status of all your services, like started, stopped, ignored, crashed, whatever. Like it is kind of cool to have all that. So. Give TrueOS a whirl. I'd be curious to hear your feedback. If you have any problems, let us know.
Especially now that TrueOS is tracking current, you get all the latest stuff sooner. So that has quite a few advantages, especially with hardware support.
That's right. Okay, so the last fellow writes in is Zach. It says, Chris and Alan, sorry to spam you guys again. I just saw this on the quarterly report. I'll be researching more about how soon could this be expected to land in TrueOS. And he mentions the Xorg update that Matt Macy had done. And he had talked about the AMD GPU support that still needed to be done. He said that'll be committed to the port tree shortly after the Xorg server update. And he says DRM from Linux 4.8 was ported to the DRM Next branch. He said this branch should be used for Radeon and AMD GPU cards. But he says the DRM Next 4.7 branch should be used for i915 cards due to instabilities with the Intel driver in the other branch. So as to when that will get into TrueOS, we will probably pull in the DRM Next branch at some point when the Intel stabilities have been worked out. Because honestly, that's a much bigger thing for us. That's more important. There's far more laptops out there that use Intel, integrated chips and desktops even, than those who are going out and buying AMD cards.
Well, there's a couple of AMD boards that have that as a built-in, but it's not the same level of user count. So the branches there, it is possible to build your own release off of that 4.8 branch, using the FreeBSD release build system is fairly simple.
You could.
If you want to try it out ahead and do bug reports so that when it finally does ship, it doesn't contain as many bugs.
Well, The one thing you could do is you don't have to rebuild the whole world. His code's actually all in the kernel. So you could potentially just rebuild the kernel on TrueOS with that particular branch and try it out.
So
see what happens. It doesn't touch user.
Okay, so in that case, yeah, you can install TrueOS, start a fresh boot environment, grab the 4.8 code off GitHub, just go into that directory, build kernel, install kernel, reboot, and see what happens.
Yep. So that's Zach who says he's never buying AMD again. Well, good to know. It doesn't help you right now, unfortunately. Yeah. But yeah, for the future, you'll know. Okay. Well, that ends our feedback and questions for the week and actually the show as well. So, of course, as we're closing now, we need to remind you to send stuff in to feedback@bsdnow.tv. That's everything. Questions, comments, show ideas, stories. If you have something you need to bring to our attention, send it there. That way it gets sent to both myself, Alan, and JT, or all three of us. And we will, of course, respond to that. You're welcome to leave comments on Twitter and elsewhere. And sometimes we see those. I tweet occasionally. And Alan, you do it a lot more than I do. But even so, I think, send it to the email address just to make sure we get a hold of it. And if you have a question, don't be anxious. It'll get on a show eventually. We have a lot we're still catching up on. So I think these were from about a month ago. So we're getting there. But keep sending them in. It'll get thrown in the queue and get onto a future episode. And, of course, we appreciate everyone taking the time to be with us this week and discuss some BSD. And we'll look forward to speaking to you same time next week.
And, we still need more interviews. So, you can do what Dexter did and twist somebody's arm until they do one for us.
That's right. So for 2017, make that one of your New Year's resolutions is find somebody for an interview and send them our way. Or if you can do one yourself because you have some expertise on something BSD related, please let us know.
We would be happy to schedule a developer. Right? You can just be a user who's done something.
Yeah. Sysadmin interviews are fun. I actually enjoy sysadmin interviews because that's kind of like in the trenches.
I definitely want to push that message too.
Yep, for sure. So we'll look forward to talking to more of you again in the future.